Would you please stand with us as we begin our service this evening? Sweet, sweet Spirit.
There's a sweet, sweet Spirit in this place, and I know that it's the Spirit of the Lord. There are sweet expressions on each face, and I know that it's the presence of the Lord. Sweet Holy Spirit, sweet heavenly
our God reigns. I'd like to welcome you to the community interdenominational Good Friday service and say thank you for God for calling us together, our brothers and sisters in Christ in ministry, for this time together. As just a bit of an introduction, I want to read a couple of verses from When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain I count but lost, and pour contempt on all my pride. Forbid me, Lord, that I should boast, save in the death of Christ my God. All the vain things that charm me most, I sacrifice them to his blood. I wore this shirt because in the front it says, it's not about me. In the back it says, it's about him. And I think Jesus did what he did for us because he said, it's not about me, it's about them. And that's all of you. And in a few moments, if you haven't already cracked open your Bible or your electronic device, you might have Isaiah 53 open, as we have several pastors who will be going through that for us tonight. But let's start with a word of prayer. Will you bow with me? Father God, we ask for your Holy Spirit to be present here. We ask that you would humble our hearts and open our souls and hearts to whatever you would show us tonight as we remember the events of Good Friday. We acknowledge, O Lord, that there is so little in us that is lovable. So often we are lovely and are not lovely in our thoughts, in our words, in our actions, and yet you still love us with a love that neither stops and starts or ebbs and flows, but a love that does not go weary, but is constant year after year, age after age. Father God, may our hearts be open to that love today. May this day, may this night create within us a love for you that's stronger than any vague word or simple sentiment. Help us with our hearts and souls this day to hear your words that came from the prophets from you some 500 years or so before Jesus was even born. And may your name be praised in our hearts and in our worship and in our lives in this community. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen.
Sin and shame are
Says that he was pierced for my rebellion. He was crushed for my sins. He was beaten so I could be whole. He was whipped so that I would be healed. He was oppressed. He was treated harshly, yet he never said a word. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter. Like a sheep is silent before his shearers, he didn't open his mouth. He is the Lamb of God. blood, for the sacrifice that you gave on that cross. As we remember that time tonight, you bought our lives. And Jesus, we thank you for that. We just want to worship you. Lord, we want to hear from your word now. Speak to our hearts. And God, just draw us closer to yourself. In your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Could I have just a little light on the lights? Thank you, I can't see. Praise God, it's an honor to be here. You know, if you haven't already opened your Bibles, open to Isaiah 53. Dissertation tonight will be enjoyable at best. And praise God. Contemplating Isaiah 53, and having preached on it a number of times, you get the gravity of what happened that day. And if you hear somebody explain to you what happened, there's people being crucified all the time. In that day and age, it was not an uncommon thing. And so, one of the questions that I've been asked when you talk to people, sometimes they go like, well, I'm a good person. I don't do anything. We're good people, aren't we? You look around you and there's good people everywhere. There's good people. And so one of the comments that I hear is, why do I need a Savior? Why do I need a Savior? Isaiah wrote this prophecy in around 700 years before the birth of Jesus. 700 years, think about it. It describes him, describes what he's going through, describes what he does. And I thought to myself, why do we need a Savior? Why do we need a Savior? You know, for good people. And so, in doing that, I thought we should start at the beginning. I won't take long on it, so hold your finger in Isaiah. One of my mother-in-law's favorite verses is the verse Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Okay. That's where it started. It started when the earth was void. There was nothing there, not even earth. I mean, you know, he just spoke it into existence, you know. Let there be light. Have you seen any of that light reflecting off of anything? Is it still going? How big is it? Let there be light, he said. In Genesis 1, I'm sorry, he created all things. And in verse 26, he said this, let us make man in our own image. Let us, there's three of them, let us make man in our own image. And so, you go to Genesis 2. And he does some other things. I especially like the part, you know, he created the animals, he did this, you know, he made all this stuff. I'm not going to go through it because it'd take too long. But in verse 7 of 2, it says that he took the ground and he formed man. He formed him with his hands. And then you know what he did? He blew into his face the breath of life. The life of God, really. And so when Adam opened up his eyes for the very first time, this is what he saw. Almighty God. How many of you have seen God face to face? Do you know the love? Remember that when you had a child, the first time you held that baby, and it could have been the first one, it could have been the last one, it could have been, You look at them and there's just love, isn't there? There's just love. Just love. I mean, like, you didn't do anything and I love you. That's the way God looked at us. God looked at Adam. Well, naturally, you know what happened? Later on, he found out. He said that, everybody has pairs. Everybody's got a mate, but Adam doesn't have a mate. And so he put him to sleep, and he made him a woman. Helped out the world, didn't it? Praise God. However, I'm going somewhere with this. Just hang on. Man became a living being, and then he got a wife. So, Genesis 3, the serpent was more subtle than all the other creatures in the field. And he went up to the woman and he said, "Did he say, can you not eat of that tree?" And she goes, "No, we're not supposed to eat of that tree. We're not even supposed to eat from it. We're not even supposed to touch it, lest we die." The devil's a liar. What did he say? He goes, "He did not say that you would surely die. He said that your eyes would be open and you'd be God." So she took the fruit and she ate of it, and it was good, and she gave it to her husband. And then her husband ate it, and all of a sudden they were naked. Well, they were naked before, but they didn't know it, did they? And so they hid themselves. They made little garments of fig leaves, and they hid. And then when God was going to come and walk with them in the evening, the cool of the evening, or the cool of the day, they were hiding. So how many of you, when you had a little one-year-old child, let's just call him Joey, and he's, "Daddy, come and find me. Joey, where are you?" You know where he is. God knew where he was. Let me just read that real quick. Hold on. I want to get it right. Anyway, I can tell you. What he said was, he said, "What happened? He said, "I didn't want to come out because I'm naked." And he said, "Who told you you were naked?" "Well, did you eat of the tree?" "Yes, I did, but it was the woman you gave me." And then she said, "It was the serpent that beguiled me." Sounds like a political thing to me. Let me just read what, and I'm going somewhere with this, so just hang on. We are getting to Isaiah 53, trust me. And so the Lord God said to the serpent, he said, "Because you've done this, you're cursed more than all the cattle and more than any beast of the field. On your belly you should go, and you shall eat dust all the days of your life. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel." I'm going to say two things, and then we're going to Isaiah 53. First of all, enmity. You know what that means? Extreme hatred. Now, you all probably never really met the devil, but maybe you don't hate him, but he hates you. If you were going to get at somebody as glorious and strong as God, and you wanted to be like him at one point in time, and you couldn't do it, how would you hurt him? You'd pick on his people, and you would take them down. "He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel." From this point on, God said, there is redemption. There is redemption. I don't know how many years it was from Genesis to Isaiah. All I know is Isaiah wrote this almost 600, 700 years before Christ. Okay? Let's just go. Isaiah 53. "Who has believed our report?" I'm going to read it and then I'm going to explain it a little bit and I'll be done. "To whom the arm of the Lord has been revealed, for he shall grow up before him as a tender plant and as a root out of a dry ground. He has no form nor comeliness, that when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him." Doesn't sound much like our Jesus, does it? You look at him, he's always beautiful. He's always beautiful on our pictures. And he is beautiful. We sing it. He is beautiful. I'm not saying he's homely. But anyway, who has believed our report? The reason they said that is because when he came and he actually did miracles where he was at. He raised Lazarus from the dead. The other young man that was in his mom and she was sore and, you know, and she was crying because she was, he was the only son and he raised him up. And he healed people. And you know what? Jesus went around doing this. He went preaching the gospel, healing the sick, and casting out devils. We don't hear much about that nowadays, do we? Do you suppose they died? I don't think so. Anyway. And to whom the arm has of the Lord has been revealed. When you talk about the arm in a prophetic word, you're talking about power. The power of God was revealed in this person that came as a baby. For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, as a root out of a dry ground. Boy, that's kind of, what's that mean? Okay. I saw a wall one time, I don't know where it was, and there was this crack in the wall and a little flower coming out of it. There was no water, no nothing. Dry ground in a prophetic manner means there's no life. When you hear about water, water coming down, washing of the water by the word, there was no water. 400 years they had not had a prophet since Malachi, I'm sorry. Okay? There had not been a prophet in Israel. And here, out of the dry ground comes this root, the root of Jesse, actually, from the line of David. He has no form nor comeliness, that when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. You know what? When he was born in an obscure stable. And he grew up and he was a carpenter's son. And I'm sure he did a very, very good job. It said he waxed, you know, he grew in stature and he also grew in the Lord, okay? In the Holy Spirit, okay? He had no form. It wasn't like a movie star coming like, whoa. Comeliness indicates stature. He didn't come in like, I'm a king. He came as a servant. He was a servant because he washed the feet of his people. Amen? Remember that? Praise God. He had no form nor comeliness, and when we see him, there's no beauty that we should desire him. But I will say this, that when Jesus walked on the earth, there were people that rejected him. But there are also people when he walked up to the boat and says, Peter, you caught some fish and that's a great thing, but come with me and I'll make you fishers of men. And Peter just left. He walked over to the boat of James and John, Zebedee's boys, and he says, follow me. And what did they do? They followed him. There was something about him and it was a love of God. One of the things I wanted to reiterate with breathing into the face of him. When they got put out of the garden, that was a sad day for Adam and Eve, wasn't it? But it was a sad day for God too. And he wants us back. Amen?
Thank you, sir. I'm going to begin with us reading this together. We've got this nice screen up here. Let's say these verses together, beginning Isaiah 53, verse 3. He was despised and rejected by mankind, a man of suffering and familiar with pain, like one from whom men hide their faces. He was despised, and we held him in low esteem. Surely he took up our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him, and afflicted. I want to remind you that the one who suffered for us, that we remember this day on the cross, is the same one who created the universe. It's the same one who created you. and all your ancestors all the way to Adam and Eve, and the same one who loves you so much, he suffered for us. He was despised and rejected by humans. A man of suffering and familiar with pain. You know, there are some people that believe that Jesus was not human. He was just a spirit being. He didn't feel pain on the cross. I want to remind us that when he went to the Garden of Gethsemane, he sweat blood. Now, doctors say when you sweat blood, you're in extreme stress. And it's a physical response. That was just thinking about what he was about to experience. The torture, the nails, the whips, the crown of thorns. I believe the people that were there would have heard his groans. He suffered much. But I believe that his physical suffering was not even close to his spiritual suffering. He was despised, and we held him in low esteem. He was separated from God for our sake. That's what sin does. When we turn away from God, when we try our own thing, when we and we hurt God, when we hurt others, sin separates us from God, from one another. Do you know what it's like to feel lonely, just to be lonely? Anybody here ever been lonely? Jesus was utterly alone because he felt the loneliness of every person who ever lived and whoever will live. That's why he said on the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me? And I believe that was the very first time he'd ever been separated from his heavenly Father. They were so close, he said, we are one. But he did that so that you and I could be forgiven, so that you and I could come back from being separated, from going our own way, from going the way of destruction, so that we could know life, so that we could know God. See, God wants so badly to know you and to be in relationship with you that he suffered in your place. That's what this is about. He was despised. And from one from whom others hid their faces. And he carried our griefs and our diseases. Yet we accounted him stricken and struck down by God and afflicted. So I want to encourage you as you remember again, as you stand before the cross again tonight, as you continue to hear the story, what God has done to know you, to be in communication with you, so you can hear him again. So you can be guided by him. Listen to his voice. Is he speaking? Open your hearts to him tonight. Know how much he loves you.
Before you go on, yeah, come here. You had a ladybug on you.
Did you guys see the ladybug on him? Because that's what you were watching when you were over here, weren't you? The ladybug instead of you. Isaiah 53, I'm going to be looking at verses 5 and 6. I remember as a child growing up in a pastor's home, we used to sing a song, "He was wounded for our transgressions." You remember that? Anybody remember that? "He was bruised for our iniquity. Surely he bore our sorrow, and by his stripes we are healed." That's where we get this that song from, this verse. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid upon him the iniquity of us all. Okay, just a second. One of the questions that we were called to look at for this evening was, what is God speaking to us as a community? What is God saying to us as a community? You know, and some people may say he's saying this, or he's saying that, or he's saying all these other things, but I think one of the things that God is saying into this community is this, that we can have peace. You know, and peace is not the absence of conflict. Some people may think that, or the absence of this, or absence of that. Peace is Jesus. Mm-hmm. And it's only by Jesus and through Jesus we can have peace. We can have the presence of God. And I looked up that word peace in the original language. It's you've heard the word shalom. Probably you use that word before, and it doesn't mean just peace, but there's several variations of what it means. It means wholeness. It means salvation. It means preservation, health, and healing, and deliverance. The word says that he was wounded. Anybody ever been wounded before? You think about it. You know, in a lot of sporting activities, when a person gets hurt or something, or gets wounded like that, they tap out and say, "Hey, coach, you need to get me out. I don't, you know, just let me, you know, recuperate from this." And you know, but Jesus didn't tap out. You know, as soon as when they started their beating on him, he didn't tap out and say, "God, I can't handle this anymore. Would you just get me out of this?" The word talks about, we see in the word, that his hands and feet were pierced. His side was pierced. They put a crown of thorns upon his head. Why? He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised. He was wounded for our sins. He suffered for our sins. Did you notice our sins, not his? The word goes on to say he was bruised for our iniquity. He was broken down by a constant pounding upon his body time and time again. What was the burden? The Father laid the burden of, laid on him the iniquity of us all. And I want to tell you something, and most of us here in this room know this. Sin is indeed a burden that grows heavier and heavier the longer we resist God. It goes on to say that with his stripes, we are healed. You know, and some may say, well, this is just referring to salvation. I believe with all my heart, it's just more than just salvation. It's more than just coming to the Lord Jesus Christ and saying a little prayer and then saying, "Okay, I'm okay." You know, there's that spiritual salvation, and that's very, very important. But there's also a physical. He comes to heal us of our disease. The Word of God talks about he is Jehovah Rapha. He is the Lord that heals us. He's a healing God. He's a delivering God. He said in the Word that I am that I am. I am who I am, or I am what I am. The Word says that Jesus himself, he took up our infirmities, and he carried away all, he bare our sicknesses. It says also in 1 Peter 2:24 that by whose stripes you were healed. Jesus also said that we would lay hands upon the sick and they would what? Recover. Isaiah 10:27 talks about that the burden shall be taken away or removed, the yoke destroyed because of the anointing. There's a verse of scripture in Mark 9:23, I believe it is, says this, if you can believe, and I believe there's a lot of believers in here, but if you can believe this, he says this, that all things are possible for those who believe. He was wounded for our transgressions. You see, he took your place. It should have been me. It should have been us. Upon that cross, he took our place. And the word goes on to say that all we like sheep have gone astray. Sheep without a shepherd get lost very quickly. Very, very quickly, easily. Man as sheep has wandered from the right path. He has become so hopelessly lost that it is impossible him for him within his own means to come back in to the right path. The word talks about that every one of us have turned from our own way. It refers to the fact that the whole world is sin and comes short of the glory of God. But God had a plan. God had a plan, and he sent his son to take away the sin of the world. The word says that the Lord laid upon Jesus the iniquity of us all. I want to say this one thing, and then I'm going to be done. Sin is very serious. It's a serious thing. The prophet calls it a transgression. We see it in the word. He calls it an iniquity, which means a rebellion against God. It's not just something that it's okay with God. It's not okay with God. And Jesus bore it all that we might live. So what is God saying to us today? What are you hearing God saying to you here this evening? We're going to be singing a song, not here tonight, but in church at where we go. And the title of the song is The Anthem. The Anthem. Here are some of the words in the song. By his stripes. I believe this is what God is speaking unto us today in our community in this season. By his stripes, we are healed. By his nail-pierced hands, we're free. Man, can't you just say hallelujah? Man, we're just free. By his blood, we're washed clean. You notice, by him, we're this. He bore it all that we... By his blood, we're washed free. Now we have the victory. And I love this part. The power of sin is broken. It's broken. It's not by anything you have done. It's not by anything that I have done. It's by everything that Jesus Christ... The power of sin is broken. Jesus overcame it all. He has won our freedom. Jesus has won it all. Then it goes on to say, hallelujah, referring to Jesus, you have won the victory. Hallelujah, you have won it all for me. Because death could not hold you down. You're the risen King, seated in majesty. You are the risen King. You see, church... Our God and Savior is risen. He is alive forevermore. Amen. And he's not, and the word talks about this, I know that God is for us. He's for you. He won the victory and he reigns on high. Can we just, before I turn it over to your pastor here, Pastor Tim, can we just shout hallelujah for what Jesus has done? Come on, shout it out. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's a great and mighty King. He's a good God and a good Father. We're just going after him because he's what it's all about. Come on up here, Pastor Tim.
Amen, man. Awesome. I love these guys. I am so thankful for them and the joy that we've had serving and being together and praying. And, you know, tonight is about we're uniting in Jesus Christ and what he's done. I have the assignment of, Isaiah 53:7-8. And it reads, he was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth, and he was led like a lamb to the slaughter. And as a sheep before his shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away. Yet who of his generation protested? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people he was punished. Now, I looked at another translation, and it reads very simply, he was unjustly condemned. He was led away. No one cared that he died without descendants, that his life was cut short, but he was struck down for the rebellion of us, you and me. What is most astonishing about this picture, what is incredibly astonishing about this picture, that it was God's idea. That it was the Father's plan. And the Son obediently came. On the one hand, the suffering Christ is an outpouring of God's wrath for us and for our sin. But on the other hand, it's Christ's suffering is a beautiful act of submission in obedience to the will of the Father. Verse 7, was oppressed and he was afflicted. Oppressed means this incredible, demanding pressure. You know, the night before he was in Gethsemane. He was in Gethsemane. The word Gethsemane actually means oil press. He was in press. This demanding oppression. And he was the Lamb of God. And you know, I shared this last Sunday at church that Josephus records that on that over that period of time, that the history indicates that there was 265,000 lambs brought to slaughter to atone for the Jews' sin. This is what Josephus says. I don't know. I don't know how accurate Josephus is, but in the midst of them was the true Lamb of God. The true Lamb of God. And we see that John the Baptist being the first one. I love what Martin Luther says about John the Baptist. You know what's incredible about John the Baptist? His finger. Because his finger, he was the first one to point to the Lamb of God, the one who takes our sin away. And he was the Lamb of God ushered in. Yet he did not open his mouth. We see it twice. He was oppressed. He was afflicted. He was silent. Now remember something. No, this chapter, as you look at this, as you heard earlier, it was 700 years prior. It was a prophecy. But look at the verbs that we see in English. If you look at them in the Hebrew, they also are pointing to their past. I don't know about you, but that blows me away. This is a prophecy going forward, but it's looking back. It's looking back. It's looking back for us that we can see, looking back today and see the healing that we have through Jesus Christ. And Zechariah 12:10, it says, "And I will pour out on the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem a spirit of grace and pleas for mercy, so that when they look on me, on him whom they have pierced, they shall mourn for him as one mourns for an only child and weep bitterly over him as one weeps for his firstborn. We are saved because we believe he was pierced for our transgressions." Verse 5. "We are saved because we believe he was crushed for our iniquities, that the punishment that came on him was for our well-being, and by his beating we are healed, his stripes. We are saved because," in verse 6, "we believe in the Lord caused the iniquity of all of us to fall on him. We are saved because," verse 8, "we believe he was cut off for our transgression." See, to become a Christian, one must believe in the substitutionary sacrifice of Christ on our behalf on the cross. I'll leave you with this thought. Jesus being fully God and fully man. Pastor Todd spoke to that earlier. Greatest human being. He had the greatest task that any human ever, human, if you will, ever faced, being fully human. He took on the sins of the world. And we praise God for that.
Our sin has created in us a desperate need. But Isaiah's song, "The Suffering Servant," it concludes with these verses, and they have this emphasis on the good news for us, on what is a fortunate inversion of our circumstances. Because of the suffering servant, we don't have to suffer the punishment that we deserve for our sins. We already read about how our healing comes from his punishment, but these last few verses, they really emphasize this incredible change in our fortunes because of what Jesus did on the cross. He gave all his perfection to redeem us from all of our transgressions, and we deserved the opposite. Yet he chose the worst, so that though we deserve the worst, we don't have to receive it. We receive the opposite as well. If we look to Isaiah 53, verses 9 through 12, we can pick out a few of these things that really point to this change in circumstances that he chose so that we could enjoy the opposite. We see there that he didn't have any violence or deceit, but his peace led to his crushing. We can see that he makes an offering, his soul makes an offering, but he's not the one that reaps the rewards. We reap those rewards. His anguish, it says, meant that God was satisfied. He was numbered with his transgressors, yet he was the one that was making intercession for those transgressors. By his sacrifice, Jesus Christ reverses the damages that have been done by sin. And those damages are incredible. He redeems God's creation. We can look back to Genesis like we did at the start. We can see how quickly sin overcame man and how dramatic that change was. How in one moment, Adam and Eve, they were walking side by side with God in paradise. And in the next, they're toiling in the dust. In one minute, they are innocent. There's no guilt or shame in their lives. And in the next, one son is killing the other. And before long, sin has so overtaken the world that God chooses to destroy it with the flood. That is how dramatic this change in circumstances from the creation to the damages of sin, that is what's happened because of sin. And when we look at that and we see the incredible, stunning upending of the estate of the world, we get an idea of the significance of what Christ is doing here, what Christ does on the cross. And really, it is the damage that he is undoing. Jesus stepped into our world and he experienced the worst of it so that we can look forward. So we can step out of this world and experience the best of that. Augustine describes this truth beautifully, and he wrote these words. He says, "The maker of man became man, that he, the bread, might be hungry, that he, the fountain, might thirst, that he, the light, might sleep, that he, the way, might be wearied by the journey, that he, the truth, might be accused by false witnesses, that he, the judge of the living and the dead, might be brought to trial by a mortal judge, that he, justice, might be condemned by the unjust, that he, discipline, might be scourged with whips, that he, the foundation, might be suspended upon a cross, that courage might be weakened, that security might be wounded, that life might die. To endure these and similar indignities for us, to free us, unworthy creatures, he who existed as the Son of God before all ages, without a beginning, deigned to become the Son of Man. He did this, although he who submitted to such great evils for our sake had done no evil, and although we, who were the recipients of so much good at his hands, had done nothing to merit these benefits." See, on that first Good Friday, Christ endured the pain of rejection and separation. He took our place to endure the punishment of sin, and he became that sacrificial lamb once and for all. See, our sin has indeed set us in desperate circumstances, but Jesus, being in the very nature God, humbled himself by being obedient to death, even death on a cross. On Good Friday, we are invited to participate in remembering the sacrifice of Jesus. That's what this night is all about, looking at the cross, looking at his suffering. And we are challenged in that to live our lives for him as a response to the fact that he gave his life for us. Our speakers and our musicians are going to come back on stage, and they're going to make their way up, because as a part of this unified worship service, we want to concisely present the gospel together, demonstrating the unity that we share in the gospel. And so I'm going to pass it back to Doug.
Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God." And like I said about before, Adam sinned and Jesus paid for it. And we're the recipient of that grace and that mercy, should we decide to.
And Jesus, when he was talking to Nicodemus, said, "Very truly, I tell you," John 3, verse 3, "no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." So it's not about you figuring it out, okay? It's God giving you new life. It's listening to God now and being guided by God's Spirit so God can make you brand new creatures.
John 14, Jesus says this. He says, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. want to just concentrate on that word way. He is the road. He is the road. He is the way to heaven. He is the way to the Father. It's only by Jesus Christ.
In Revelation 3:20, we see it written that Jesus stands at the door and knocks. And anyone who opens that door receives this gift, this free gift that's given to us because of what he accomplished on the cross, that we have this new life. He knocks on everyone's door.
As we conclude with Romans 10, 9, and 10, we start to see answers to questions about what do we do with this gospel, with this good news. 10, 9, and 10, Paul says that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. We know what a confession is. It's to say what is true. It's to tell the truth. We're inviting all the ministers, all of them that are here tonight, to come forward because we want to offer a chance for everyone to respond to this gospel message, to have an opportunity to come forward and talk to someone. It might be that you've never received Christ into your life. You've never trusted him for your salvation. And if you need to do that today, you're invited to come forward and talk to one of us. It might be that you've been a believer for a long time, but you're seeking restoration or prayer, and you're invited to come up for that as well. As we close, we're going to be singing a final song, and you're invited to come forward and talk to us if you need to receive prayer and encouragement. We'll be singing, Lord, I Need You.
we want to send you off with this kind of a benediction in video, if you just enjoy this for a couple of minutes.
We are marked by the lines where spines have been, by the calluses of our labor, by the scars of our struggles, and by the strength of our prayers, all of which tell the story of who we are. Yet there's another mark, one that sets us apart from others and from who we once were. Unlike our physical marks, this mark can't be seen by human eyes, nor felt by human touch. Yet it's as present as the wind in the trees, for it is the mark of whose we are, rather than who we are. We are not our own. Our stories, our struggles, our victories, and our joys are all part of something larger, something greater than ourselves. This journey we call life is not about finding ourselves so much as it is about losing ourselves and finding Him. As we move toward discovering Him, we become free to explore the depth and breadth of His love and His being. We realize that being a saved people doesn't mean we are safe people, set upon a shelf to await His return. No, we're not safe, but rather we're sent from a comfortable place in society to the outcasts and the vulnerable, from an easy definition of friend and family to an ability to embrace the enemy with God's love, from inside the church walls to a world outside that needs Jesus. Our vision is to join God in His mission, to go wherever we must and do whatever it takes to penetrate the darkness and rescue the lost. We are set apart. We're marked. We are not our own. We are His.
Father, we thank You for tonight. We thank You for the worship, the time that we had together. Lord, we thank You that You are our Lord and that we belong to You. Lord, I pray Your blessing on each family here tonight, that You'll go with them, filling their hearts. Lord, as we prepare to celebrate Resurrection Sunday, Lord, give us a joy that cannot be explained but anything but by Your hand. Oh, Lord, we love You. We praise Your name. In Jesus I pray. Amen. Have a great Easter.